Good morning. I don't know if we've got better light or not so good a light because I don't have the little selfie light that has, I think, added a little bit of light, the right kind of light. Excuse me, because it's different lights and some help you look a little better on here and some don't. So nonetheless, we're here and we're not here for ourselves. We're here to tell you things about God and God's word. So it's good to see Biff on here this morning. We're in Revelation chapter 18, and the whole world system is getting ready to crumble, and that's Revelation 18. So Benita, good to see you. Biff, good to see you. We've kind of reviewed, but I believe right here from Revelation 18 all the way through chapter 22, it's going to be new stuff for us. So we're just going to go through it. I don't know how far we'll get today. But in chapter 18, the kings of the world have been drunken with the fornication and the corruption and all the fun stuff, okay, right? Let's just be honest. There's a little bit of fun in sin. There's a little bit of fun in corruption, especially when you're on receiving end of all this money and everything, right? But there's going to come a time, and Benita, we see it at your unspoken prayer request. Anybody that has a prayer request, please leave it here. Unspoken prayer request. God knows all about it. If you want to mention something specifically, God, you know, God's all about that too. And we'll pray and share this as others come and look at this throughout the day. So there's a lot to be prayed for, especially as we get into these things here and see the world system and all the things that are lining up and all the powers of the world. Because, you know, we talk about 10 federated kingdoms, which I guess, you know, they're going to be the 10 kingdoms that kind of rule this thing. You know, but they got their power from the Antichrist. And then the Antichrist is going to have, well, he's not going to have them, but God's going to have them destroy this world system. And then they're going to turn all their affection and all their devotion toward the Antichrist. And that's what we're getting into today. So who's going to be the last people standing? Well, it's going to be the merchants. It's going to be the people with a ship that can go get goods and still transport goods. But, you know, we've seen half the sea destroyed. We've seen all the sea destroyed in the vile judgments. So now we're into this thing where, you know, as it's coming down to the very end and God is dropping one domino after another, if you will, and knocking one thing out after another, now Babylon has fallen. Now, what is the key to Babylon falling? Well, there's a lot of people that think our economy can never fail. And every time we get into a bind, like we have been with COVID and like we got into in 2006 and 2007 with mortgages, people start yelling, well, this is too big to fail. It's too big to fail. Well, there's coming a day when it don't matter how big it is. The bigger they are, the harder they fall, right? That's what we've always grown up here. And so it's going to fall. And its reason it's going to fall has a lot to do with Revelation 18, verse 4. It says, all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies. Now, what in the world is her delicacies? It's the luxury. It's the lifestyle. It's all these things that feed this materialistic thing. And I was watching The Men That Built America the other night, and it was during the J.P. Morgan years and just about the time of the stock market crash when all these rich people decided to make more money on our money. What we've got to do is start loaning money out. And that's where credit and buying on time happened. So the stock market was surging to such an extent back then that people would borrow the money from the bank and then go buy stocks with it with a thought of getting rich quick, right? We've all had those thoughts. So let's think about this. It's no different here today. There's a lot of people that believe in their politics. There's a lot of people that believe in the stock market, that believe in this world system, and they won't come out of the world to have a relationship with Jesus. But in Revelation 18, it clearly says Babylon is fallen. It is going to fail. The world system, everything that you think is important is going to fail, and you're going to be left standing there understanding that only Jesus matters, but then it's going to be too late for you to make the decision to come over. And that's what the heartbreaking part is. So Verse 5 says, for her sins have reached unto heaven, and God has remembered her iniquities. So this tribulation period with these 10 kings, okay, they're getting ready to destroy this harlot system. They will do this at God's will. And we touched on this just about the time we quit yesterday. God can use evil to accomplish his will, right? Because these ten kings probably aren't in heaven, right? But what they do is they do God's will, and God's will was to destroy the harlot system because everybody had drunk of the corruption. And you know, it's just like the United States of America. We want to think that we're this blessed, wonderful, sweet, kind, you know, benevolent group of people. But the truth is, we inflict a lot of pain and heartache on a lot of other countries. And we do bribe them, and we do give them funding. And, you know, it does drive a lot of people crazy. But all that stuff is bribes. All that stuff is corruption. The China thing, the Russia thing, the Biden kid selling the art for millions. You know, it's a Ponzi scheme. It's a money laundering scheme. All these things are right ripped from the headlines of your Bible today. So once again, it's not a Democrat thing. It's not a Republican thing. It's just pure destruction that's in all this. And that's just the way it is. So to give you just a little bit about how the reference is, it says in verse 2, her doom is announced. Babylon the Great is fallen. The reference to devils and every foul spirit shows the total destruction and utter desolation of the harlot system. All nations, this system had worldwide influence and control for the wine and the fornication. C17:2, that kind of roll back a little bit. Rich were the merchants of the earth who had become wealthy through the apostate, idolatrous system centered at Rome. So why were the merchants rich? Because no matter what you got to do, you're going to buy because you got to buy to eat, right? But now you had to have the mark of the beast, see? So the merchants, they lasted to the end because they took the mark of the beast because their business was business and selling. And they, you know, they're going to sell to the end. So we're going to come into a few more verses and you're going to be like, whoa, this is crazy. So we get down here and here it is in verses, Revelation 18, verses 4 through 8. The believer must separate themselves from the harlot system. It's no different than right now. See, if you love the world, the love of God is not in you. That's what John, 1 John says. And 1 John is written by John, and John wrote the book of Revelation. So if I love the corruption and the chaos and the perversions and just the plumb crazy that's going on in the world today, and I get enjoyment out of watching that craziness, the love of God's not in me. Because we should be brokenhearted about the things that we see and how God set this country up and had 56 men that relied on him in prayer, relied on God, and asked God to lead and to providentially care for them and deliver them from their enemies. And now we're into this situation, you follow me, where we look and it's just gone to shambles. Now, people say, well, you still don't understand. We're still living in the greatest time in human history. We're still living in the greatest country in the world. And all those luxuries are what I've just read you, and how it's going to be real difficult for you to pull yourself out of the world and to realize that you have a need for somebody that you cannot see, yet someone who has preserved his Bible for thousands of years for you. So there's where our problem is. So the double judgment here emphasizes full punishment for her sins. That she calls herself a queen and no widow shows her arrogant self-confidence. She sees herself as beyond any possibility of personal sorrow. But the humbling of the harlot will involve torment and sorrow. One day may be a literal day or a symbol for a suddenness of the destruction. The fire may also be a literal fire or symbolic of the judgment of God. So as we get into this and we start to see, you know, the system crumbling, the economy crumbling, the things that we thought could never fail begin to fail. Okay. Now we're starting to understand of what she's getting. So let me get down here to about verse 9, and I'll read you. It says, "And the kings of the earth who have committed fornication and lived deliciously with her shall bewail her and lament for her when they shall see the smoke of her burning." So the kings and the systems and all that power and all that luxurious living, you know, I think about this Jerry Epstein and that woman, how they basically sex traffic children, and they've got some of the most powerful people in the country are involved in this thing. You know, I don't know how far the judgment on this is going to go, but I do know that there's going to be an ultimate judgment where the people who have exploited children and taken advantage of children and taken advantage of everybody in general, you're going to pay for that. So the best thing for you to do today, if that's you, is to get away from that. Because right here it says the kings of the earth who have committed this fornication, the people who have been in the corruption, the people who have enjoyed it and made money off of it and lived this lifestyle of the jet set and the rich and the famous, they're going to bewail and lament her when they see the systems being destroyed. Oh, do you remember how we used to live? Right? Do you remember the way it was? So the kings of the earth, you know, they're standing afar off for fear of torment. So see, now they've distanced themselves, but it's too late. This is verse 10 in Revelation 18. "Standing afar off for the fear of torment, saying, alas, alas, that great city Babylon, that mighty city, for in 1 hour is thy judgment come." See, there's a sudden stop. You know, I was telling my little girl, she got her driver's license the other day. And she doesn't care to put the pedal to the metal and head on down the highway. And I said, you know, that's fine on interstate. I said, but you really have to be careful, because in a car, it's that sudden stop. You don't realize that even at 10 miles an hour, you know, when that car hits that sudden stop at 10 miles an hour, I mean, it jolts your body. And depending on what you hit, it might tear your car up. And it's the same thing right here. In the space of 1 hour, the whole world economy, everything a lot of people have ever believed in, stock market crash, 1929, people are jumping out the windows of their buildings, stepping in front of trains. All these crazy things are happening. So in 1 hour is thy judgment come, meaning it failed. It dropped off the face of the earth. It came to nothing, and all of a sudden everybody starts looking around, and they're standing, they're watching it burn, and they're realizing, you know what? This didn't mean anything. All that I had, all that I lived, the luxurious lifestyle, the you know, being popular, being fancy, being whatever you are, and there it is. "And the merchants of the earth shall weep and mourn over her, for no man buyeth their merchandise anymore." See, there's nothing to buy, right? There's no way to buy. The system has collapsed. I'm not going to take your paper money, because guess what? There's nothing backing the money up now. The harlot system, the one world order, the government has fallen. What am I going to trade? Well, probably go back to the barter system, right? If you've got something I want, I may trade it for something that, you know, you want or whatever, see? "So the merchandise of gold and silver and the precious stones of pearl and fine linen and purple and silk and scarlet and all fine wood and all manner vessels of ivory and all manner vessels of most precious wood and of brass and iron and marble and cinnamon and odors and ointments and frankincense and wine and flour and beast and sheep and horses and chariots and slaves and souls of men and the fruits that thy soul lusted after are departed from thee, and all things which were dainty and goodly are departed from thee, and thou shalt find them no more at all." There's nothing left. There's no Walmart. There's no gallon of milk and a loaf of bread and a package of bologna. It's gone. There's no way. It's not here. The power grid's knocked out. There's no refrigeration. Can't keep a gallon of milk. And I think so much about this after the COVID lockdown was God showing us something. And what he showed us is we can't survive very long on our own. Now, hopefully, you know, I'm not even going to get into it. But, I mean, people that canned their food for, you know, my mom, papa's, you know, that did all this stuff out here, you know, I mean, They would roll over in their graves if they knew just how poorly prepared we were for these types of things. I mean, it's not going to take very long for the agony to set in. Now, granted, this is coming down near the 7 years of tribulation, so there's already been agony, right? But who made it through? The merchants made it through and the kings, because they had all the power. But even they are starting to see that this world system, that the one true God is going to take it all the way down to the dirt. And the merchants realize that they cannot sell anymore, and they're weeping, but they're standing afar off for fear of torment, but they're weeping and they're wailing. So they're trying to distance themselves. See, when the judgment comes, we'll be trying to distance ourselves from that evil. We can't distance ourselves because we were knee-deep in it. Now, the church, us that are saved, we're going to be gone. This won't be anything to us. But all these people that have drunk of the wine and the fornication, and they've lived deliciously, which is to say they have lived luxuriously, they've lived the jet set lifestyle, they've had no need of anything, they've exploited people, right, for their own gain, and that's where we're going to be at. So in 1 hour, so great riches is come to naught. And every shipmaster and all the company in ships and sailors and as many as trade by sea, they stood afar off and they cried when they saw the smoke of the burning, saying, what city is likened unto the great city? Man, what else do we have? You know, we see Bitcoin and these cryptocurrencies and, you know, all this stuff that there's faith in this currency, but there's never been any faith in any monetary system other than what backed up the monetary system. And everywhere in the world right now, the United States dollar is about the standard, right? But it's coming, it's ending, it's going to be the end of the road. And by verse 19, they cast dust on their heads and they cried, weeping and wailing, alas, alas, that great city wherein were made rich all that had ships in the area by reason of her costliness, for in 1 hour she is made desolate. 1 hour, it just was over just like that. And then it says, rejoice over her there heaven, and ye holy apostles and prophets, for God hath avenged you on her. So what is the tribulation period again? Yep, you're exactly right, Myrtle. Your mother was 100% accurate. And money won't be worth anything. And even what we said here, even the gold and silver, because every time we get around to some inflation, you know, they start running those commercials on TV, buy gold and silver, buy gold and silver, buy gold and silver. Well, you can buy all you want. It ain't going to hedge against anything during this period of time. So by verse 20, there's some rejoicing going on from the people that have been persecuted and killed by the world system, by people not wanting to hear about Jesus, by people, you know, insisting on the corruption, that they would not, you know, hear the gospel, they would not hear the good news, they would not hear that our God was a righteous God who wanted a royal priesthood of believers, and, you know, he wanted all these great things instead of all this destruction. So God has avenged her on you. So God at last judges the Babylonian system for its treatment of God's people, particularly those who are martyred during the tribulation period. So verse 20 shows heaven's perspective on the judgment. And that, what happens in heaven? Excuse me. They rejoice over her. Thou heaven and ye holy apostles and prophets, for God hath avenged you on her. So that's the best thing, right? That's where we're at in this thing. So we move a little bit further and we get over here into, you know, the party continues in heaven, verses 21 through 24. Well, let me just read it to you so we don't leave it out. These verses picture from within the results of the collapse of the Babylonian system. The finality of the destruction is shown by the sixfold repetition of the phrase, no more at all. The stone cast into the sea depicts the violence and permanent destruction the Babylonian system began in Genesis chapter 10 and has continued uninterrupted in one form or another to the present day. One day it will suddenly sink, never to return. In verses 23 and 24, three reasons are given for the destruction of Babylon. It's arrogance. How many people do we know that have self-destructed their own lives over their own arrogance? Second was its deception of the nations. And third is its persecution and martyrdom of God's people. So what's the description of the nations, or the deception of the nations? By telling people we're going to do the right thing. If you elect me, I'm going to take care of you. I'm going to think about you. I'm going to support my community. I'm going to do all these things. And I deceived you because I got the power. And when I got the power, I used it for my own greedy gain. There it is. It's not me making this stuff up for you this morning. So what do I got to do? You got to separate yourself right now. You got to get to Jesus. You got to start a relationship with Jesus. And does it mean quit your job? No. Does it mean, you know, I mean, it just means if you accept Jesus, the Holy Spirit's going to come in your life and he's going to separate you gradually out of the things of the world that you're in love with. If you say you're saved, but yet you can't lay those things of the world down, right? And you can't say, man, I got to get away from this. I got to get away from, you know, maybe politics. Maybe politics is the thing you got to get away from. You know, I put Jesus first on my campaign sign. A lot of people said, well, that was stupid. You'll never win anything with that. But the test was not for me. The test was to see how many Christian people would believe that Jesus had the power to be first. You know, does it matter who Jesus uses? Because Jesus used a little boy called David to kill a giant that no grown man was willing to go out in faith. Face, right? God took the poorest person ever lived, you know, and pulls them out and puts them in a place of power and worship. Or not worship, you know, don't worship people. But I mean, look at Joseph. He was the least of the 12 sons of Jacob. All the other brothers wanted to kill him, and God put him as the number two man in Egypt. So for all the people that don't think God's interested in politics, you know, he's interested in his people being interested. And he's interested in people doing the right thing when they get into these positions. But because from Genesis chapter 10 all the way through, the corruption is such that if people get a little bit of power, their pride and their arrogance just drives them crazy. And that's why you need to be, you need to elect godly leaders. Now, how much time do we have left? Well, I don't know, because I've given you the analogy. Genesis, Revelation. We got to be right here based on human history, right? So how much more is there? How much more craziness can we expect before God says, that's it, I'm taking the church out of here, start the tribulation clock. All right, let's go to chapters 19 and 20. We're coming to the climax of the book of Revelation. The return of Jesus Christ is established with his millennial kingdom where he sits on a throne on this earth at Jerusalem. But now, let's look at some things, okay? There's five verses here that show heaven's response to the judgment of the harlot system. The multitude in heaven praise God for judging the great whore and avenging the blood of the martyrs. The word alleluia is equivalent to hallelujah, which means praise Yahweh or praise the Lord, okay? So every time you say hallelujah, you are saying praise the Lord. But see, a lot of times we don't realize what we're doing. We say things because people have said them for 1,000 years, but we have no idea. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. We probably need to do more of it. I guarantee we do. So, amen derives from a Hebrew word meaning to be firm and be translated truly or so be it. So when I pray and at the end we say, we pray all these things in Jesus's name, amen, which is to say, let it be, right? So be it, Lord. So now I get down to verse 6 through 10, the marriage supper of the Lamb. We've always heard about that. When does the marriage supper of the Lamb happen? How is it significant? How come us Gentiles don't really understand it? Well, let me explain the marriage plan for the Jewish folks, and now you'll get to understanding of how this thing happens. So, at the return of Jesus Christ, the bride of Jesus Christ is the church, right? So the marriage is the eternal union, eternal union. If you're a member of the church, you will never be left. You will never be forsaken. You will never be out of the presence of the Lord, okay? So because of that, I ought to be wanting to seek to be in God's presence as much as I can. And since he lives inside of me, if I'll read and study this Bible and I'll hear some Sunday school and I'll go to church and get in with a bunch of believers that are serious about God and God's work, you will find out that you will grow into the Christian God wants you to be. So we go a little further. The union comes, okay, following the rapture of the church. The fine linen, clean and white, represents the righteousness of the church, which has now been judged and purified at the judgment seat of Christ. Now, what is the judgment for the Christian? Well, the Christian is going to be judged and given rewards for the things he did or didn't do as a Christian. Because, see, he's not going to be judged for sin because he asked Jesus to forgive him of his sins the moment that he got saved. Does that make sense? So when I asked Jesus to forgive me, I became a new creature in Christ. Jesus looked at me like I was born brand new right then. So I moved forward. Now, I wasn't always perfect, right? And in fact, I've never been perfect. And we still sin because in 1 John, it tells me if I say I don't sin as a Christian, then I'm a liar and the truth is not in me. What is the truth that's in me? That's the Holy Spirit that heightens my conscience and all of a sudden has helped me to understand that, look, you better straighten up. You better pay attention because guess what? You're not perfect. Don't get into the pride and the arrogant game because guess what? That was the number one reason for the perishing of this one group of people is their pride and their arrogance was so much that they didn't, you know, their power and their need for power was so much, there was nothing you could do for them. So that's where it's at. So the marriage supper of the Lamb represents the millennial kingdom of Christ, which will take place on earth following the return of Jesus Christ. Now, here is the Jewish marriage, and here is why this is, you know, broken down the way it is. So the Jewish marriage consisted of three major elements. The betrothal. Where are we at right now? We're at the betrothal. How do we know? Because Jesus said in John 14, I go to prepare a place for you. And when I go and prepare a place for you, when I get it done, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. So there's the betrothal. We're in that age right now. So the second part of it is the presentation. What's the presentation? It's when the church comes together at the rapture with Jesus Christ, right? And the third part of this thing is the marriage feast or the supper. So figuratively, with reference to the church, the betrothal takes place on earth during the church age. We're in it right now. We're waiting on the groom to come back and take the bride out of here. The presentation will take place in heaven following the rapture of the church. So the presentation of us to our groom could happen any moment because guess what? The tribulation or the rapture of the church could happen at any second. So the marriage feast will take place on the earth following Christ's return with the church. So at the end, are we fighting behind Jesus in the battle of Armageddon? I do not know. But when the 1,000-year millennial reign is set up, because see, a lot of people would have you to believe we're in the tribulation period already, and we just couldn't be there. Because we're going to leave this world, and then we're going to come back for the 1,000-year millennial reign. And we're going to come back as the bride of Christ as that period is going to be fulfilled. So during the 1,000-year millennial reign, only God will be worshipped. So the person and the message of Jesus is the essence of all true prophecy. You got me? So when I get down here to verses 19 and 11, it says, I saw heaven opened and a white horse. And he that sat upon him was called faithful and true, and in righteousness he does judge, and he makes war. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew. And he himself, he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of the mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he should rule them with a rod of iron, and he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and the wrath of the Almighty God, and he hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And I saw an angel standing in the sun, and he cried with a loud voice, saying, to all the fowls that fly in the midst of heaven, come and gather yourselves together unto the supper of the great God. And they that where they may eat the flesh of the kings, and the flesh of captains, and the flesh of mighty men, and the flesh of horses. So what are we talking about here? Jesus is getting ready to ride through on his white horse at the Battle of Armageddon. So here he comes, the true Messiah. He returns victorious in conquest. He's faithful to his word and to his promises. So once again, why did we call him the Word of God? Because in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So when I hold this Bible called also the Word of God, it's no different than Jesus telling me himself everything that I read here. So we got to take this Bible more seriously. We got to realize how true it is. We got to realize how right it is. And at the end of the day, none of this other stuff is ever going to matter. I'm telling you, whatever's going on in your life, you need to talk to your family. You need to talk to your friends. You need to make up with your enemies. You need to tell people that they got to get to Jesus while the getting is good, as Grandma used to say. All right, so here we go. In Jesus' first advent, Jesus especially revealed the love and the grace of God. Okay, but in his second advent, he will reveal the holiness, justice, and judgment of God. So when the battle of when the world system lined up by the devil and the Antichrist and the false prophet, you know, these armies, okay, man, I mean, it's just going to be, I mean, it's no battle. You know, they're just going to blow through it. So the armies, okay, following Jesus could be angels. They could be the raptured church. They could be the inhabitants of the heavenly Jerusalem. They could be the angels, the church, and the spirits of the Old Testament and tribulation saints. They will share in Christ's victory and glory. The linen symbolizes the righteousness. The sword from his mouth depicts judgment. Through his spoken word, smite the nations. Christ will destroy all unbelievers. The rod of iron, Christ will subject all nations to himself and destroy all of his enemies. His King of Kings and Lord of Lords is this. Christ has universal sovereignty. He is king over all who call themselves kings and Lord over all who call themselves Lord. So the supper of the great God is not the same as our married supper of the Lamb. Here God calls the fowls or the birds and of the air together. Because guess what? We've got to clean up this mess from all these people that were killed at the Battle of Armageddon. All the unbelievers that are wiped out. So the armies of the beast and of the kings of the east will gather in Palestine at Armageddon in an attempt to prevent the kingdom of Christ. Christ will immediately defeat and capture the beast and the false prophet. These will become the first inhabitants of the lake of fire. The rest of the kings and the armies will be killed by the word of Christ and will be eaten by the birds. The unbelieving survivors of the tribulation will be judged by Christ, and they also will be sentenced into everlasting fire. And that's where we'll end today. So once again, God came the first time, sent his son Jesus to give you love and to give you grace. But the next time Jesus touches down on this earth at the Battle of Armageddon, there's no love and there's no grace because they've decided to be unbelievers. They've decided to follow the beast. And all they can have is total destruction. And God lines up the animals and the fowls of the earth in order to come in and clean up the mess and the blood and eat it. Can you imagine the buzzards? For all those that know where Hamlin, West Virginia is, I haven't seen the buzzards as much, but I mean, they were a sight to see, all them buzzards and them trees over there. It's going to be a lot worse at the Battle of Armageddon because all these people, all the unbelievers of the world are going to line up to fight, and they're all going to be wiped out. So we're going to pray. We've got a lot of unspoken prayer requests, got a lot of spoken prayer requests. So just leave them here, and we'll go through them throughout the day. So, Lord, we're thankful for the information. We're thankful that you gave us a period of love and grace. And we're thankful that we won't be here for this period of tribulation and hell on earth. But Lord, we want you to give us the power to go to our family and our friends and our enemies, the power to say, I'm sorry, the power to tell other people that whatever we got going on between us, we got to stop it. We got to get serious about the things of God and realize all these other things are not going to matter. They will not matter. And that's where we're at today. So, Lord, we love you. We thank you for all that you've done for us and all that you will do. We're trying to get to a position, Lord, where we can be better prepared to do the things that you want us to do. And again, Lord, there is a great opportunity, because people, if they know anything about hell, if they know anything about Babylon, if they know anything about destruction, you've got to be able to look at the world systems and the corruptions of the governments around the world, including our own government, and see time has got to be short. So, Lord, we always want you to remember our men and women in the military all over the world protecting us. We ask you to protect them and keep them safe wherever they are. Our policemen, our firefighters, our first responders, we appreciate these people. We just want to respect them. We want to protect them. We want to, you know, let them know how appreciative we are. We want to get the respect back. And the best thing that government can do is to enforce the law. And a lot of the corruption, a lot of the destruction, a lot of the chaos is straight out of this Bible, the things that are going on in society today. So, Lord, we love you. We ask you to forgive us where we fail you. We thank you that you gave us so much in writing in this Bible that we can know and we can do and we can be what you want us to be. Again, forgive us where we fail you, and we'll give you the praise, the honor, and the glory for it all. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. We love you in Jesus. We appreciate you guys. We hope you have a wonderful day, and we will talk to you soon.